Now, this is going to come as a shock to most of you. However, I have not always been this fine-tuned athlete as I am standing before you today. Rather, I had my humble beginnings in my backyard, growing up in my house with my father, and something special about my comings of an athleticism was that the phrase, keep your eye on the ball, took me an exceedingly greater amount of time to grasp than what normal children would grasp it in. You see, this phrase, keep your eye on the ball, to me, meant, literally, keep your eye on the ball until it hits you in the face. And over and over and over again, playing catch with my dad, I would catch the ball with my face. It just dawned on me that this padded glove that would be on my hand would work as an excellent mechanism to put in front of my face to stop the ball from hitting me there. But regardless of the time that it took, the number of times Dad would rush me inside to Mom to grab an ice pack, and when we could take a minute to rest before we go back out and play catch, the more and more those times happened, the more and more my dad came up beside me, and he stayed with me, and he said, son, it's going to be okay. Next time, just keep your eye on the ball. And as he kept reminding me of that, I'm forever indebted to his time that he spent, the countless hours where he'd come home from a long day of work, working 8 to 10 hours a day, he'd come home, take off some of his work clothes, and I would run up to him with two gloves in hand, and he would put on his glove, and we'd go out in the backyard and we'd play. We played catch, and he had the patience of a saint as he sat there and worked with me, time and time again, often into the hours of the night where we have to go turn on the lights because we would keep playing. I wasn't good, and I wasn't understanding the concept of what it meant to keep my eye on the ball. But regardless of that, my dad stood by me, and he kept trying. He never gave up. Regardless of those feelings that my dad had, and I'm sure he was feeling some kind of frustration, as this is a simple task. A father and a son, they play catch in the backyard, it's just what they do. You catch the ball, you don't keep dropping it. And as I could see this frustration in my dad, it never consumed him to the point where he would stop. He always kept working with me until I got it. And now to this day, while I'm far from a professional ball player, I'm able to have a game of catch and not use my face to catch the baseball because of the time that my dad spent working with me. Whether you're like me, who took a lot longer to learn how to play this game of sports, or whether you're naturally athletically gifted, I feel like today's scripture comes to us from an author who had all of us in mind. Now, before you go saying, Cody, did you not pay attention in systematic theology? All scripture is God-breathed, and it's meant to be living and breathing in all of us. Well, yes, that is true, but I'm not going to argue that. I want to quantify that with today's author and that he wrote an orderly account for us as believers, so that we would come to a greater assurance of the truthfulness of the material that he's presenting. Today's author wrote to believers whose hearts he expected to burn within them after reading his message, that they would be further edified in their walk with Christ. And it is my prayer today that Luke's message would build on our prior knowledge and understanding and start that fire or rekindle that fire that is in each and every one of our hearts. You see, today's parable is located in such a specific location in Luke's gospel. We're coming just out of a section where Jesus uses the demise at the Tower of Siloam, where 18 people were killed. He's coming right out of this section, and he's using this as a section of condemnation to the readers, to his audience. And this parable comes just after that as a reassurance of hope. But as we go into this parable today, I want you to hold on to that uneasiness of those 18 lives that were taken at the tower. I want you to hold on to that feeling of condemnation as we go into this passage and are reminded of the hope. If you will turn with your Bibles with me to Luke chapter 13, verses 6 and 7. And he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came seeking fruit on it and found none. And he said to the vine dresser, "Look, for 3 years now I've come, seeking fruit on this tree, and I find none. Now cut it down. Why should it use up the ground?" Who do you identify with in this story? Do you identify with the owner of the vineyard? Or do you identify with the vine dresser, the farmer in this story? Or do you identify as the fig tree? Because I know for me, being at Bible college, being this good Christian that everyone expects of me, I want to identify with the owner. I want to be that person who can look into other people's lives and be like, wow, we need improvement here. We need to do something. Or at the very least, I want to be that farmer, the person who's cultivating other believers and trying to get the garden to continue to grow and be fruitful. But if I'm being real, if I'm being honest, I'm the tree. Yeah. The person preaching today is the tree. The person who's about to graduate from Bible college is the tree. But in reality, we are all the tree in the garden. We are the unfruitful tree planted in the garden. We are sometimes growing, but not producing. Are you being fruitful? You see, some of us, there are some in here who are the fruitful tree. They are producing. And my encouragement to you is to keep on doing that. You are doing so great. Please hear this, not as an ego-boosting thing, but as a thing to keep encouraging you in your walk. But the reality is that most of us, we're not doing that. We aren't living out that life. What is holding us back from being fruitful? You know, for me, what's holding me back from being fruitful is the idea of being fruitful enough. You see, I'm at Bible college, I'm studying to be a minister, and I began to start this mindset of, well, I've been in class all day, I've been studying the Bible, so why do I need to go home and continue to read on my own? Why should I wake up early when I already have to get up for an 8 a.m. class to read the Word of God? And you see, this isn't something that just happened overnight. It's something that throughout my college career just slowly came down, and within this past semester has been something that's been incredibly convicting to me. Now, I know what you're probably thinking. Why is he up there saying that? Everyone says that. It's just an annoying gong that just keeps ringing. All right, Cody, you're beating the dead horse now. But I wonder, if anyone else in here has done this, if we've fallen into this mindset of just good enough, we've fallen into the trap that we don't need the Word of God in our lives because we are at Bible college. We're good enough. We're better than most, right? And I know it's a cliche, and I know it's something that's repeated over and over and over again. But I believe it is not without reason and without cause. You see, Romans chapter 11 records for us a drastic image of what happens to all those who fall out of the Word and who are not growing. You see, at first, Paul starts out, and he wouldn't seem to be a very terrible thing. Yeah, the story starts out as Paul describing this dead branch that's cut from the tree, and those who are brought in and grafted into the tree of life, they are being able to be supported by the tree. The roots are feeding that branch, and it's grafted in and it's growing. But it's all too easy to forget the reality of what had happened. The farmer cut out the dead branch and threw it to the burn pile. The dead branch that wasn't producing in the tree just got cut out. So while this is an amazing message that we get to hear, that we are crafted into the tree, it's important to not forget that the opposite is also true, that the dead will be cut out. Because the original branch had died, God had came in and he had cut it out so that we could be grafted in, and that we could have life. For if God did not separate the natural branches, neither would he spare you. Romans 11:21. But luckily for us, we are not left alone to do this. This parable continues on in verse 8. Luke records, and he answered him, "Sir, let it alone this year also, until I dig around it and put on manure, until I put on poop." You see, getting pooped on is never a comfortable thing. I mean, it doesn't even sound good. That just sounds gross and weird and ewy. But the benefits that that poop is going to provide greatly impacts the health of what it is put on. For those times that we are not producing fruit, we need the farmer to bring in poop and turn up the soil around us so that we can receive the proper nutrients in order to produce fruit. We need the poop. We need that farmer who's dedicated to getting his hands dirty and getting in there, just mixing it up, returning the nutrients to the soil, aerating the soil, bringing in new life into the soil. Getting pooped on is never a comfortable thing. However, if it weren't for the uncomfortability of having the dirt turned up around us and the poop thrown on us, our reality would be that of Romans 11. We would die, we'd be cut off, and we'd be thrown into the burn pile. Yes, we believe, and yes, we know that Jesus is our Savior, and of course we believe that. That's all great and good, but what happens when we just stop there? Is that good enough? Are we doing justice to the gospel message by just standing there? Dead branches are dead branches. And a tree that is not producing fruit is wasting valuable space in the garden. The owner of the vineyard is correct when coming to the farmer and saying, "Hey, look, I've waited for this tree for 3 years. It should have been producing fruit, and it hasn't." It's wasting money. It's wasting time. It's wasting effort. It's just sitting there being a drain on the soil, when in reality, we can dig it up and put something else in its place and begin to make money again, to begin to be fruitful again, to not be wasting the space. As a result, both the dead branches and the unproductive tree have no other value than to be thrown in the burn pile so that when winter comes, the farmer and the owner can have warmth and that they can return even somewhat semblance of nutrients back to the soil from burning the plant. However, we serve a merciful and forgiving God who comes and stands for us like the farmer does the fig tree. The story does not end there. It ends with verse 9. "Then, if it should bear fruit next year, well and good, but if not, we cut it down." You see, Jesus intervenes in this story for us. While we shouldn't be taking advantage of grace, it's so comforting to know that even though that there are times in our lives where we might mess up, where we might not be producing fruit, where we might just be existing in the garden, that the great farmer, that Jesus, will not let us be torn and thrown into the burn pile, but rather, in times of need, Jesus is not afraid to get his hands dirty. He's not afraid to go grab a handful of poop, mix it up into the soil so that we can have the nutrients of life, so that we can, again, bear fruit. He will still intercede on our behalf, even though we don't deserve it, even though we continue to mess up. He loves us so much that he's willing to do this. Our farmer is so concerned about us that he not only is willing to get his own hands dirty, but he's also willing to enlist the help of ranch hands in each of our lives, because we are that valuable to him. Not only do we have an owner who cares about his farm and his well-being, but we have a farmer who's caring for and tending to each of the plots. But now we have ranch hands that he's enlisted in each and every one of our lives so that we may continue to grow and to thrive, because we are that valuable to him. Believe it or not, we are in the presence of some of the finest ranch hands in this room. From the first day of Greek, Mrs. Paddock destroyed the ground around me. And that first week, I sat in the library just broken. Like, there's no way I could do this. I'm not nearly smart enough for this. There is absolutely no way I could continue on. And as I'm sitting there resolving with myself, I put my hands on my face and I'm just sitting there, head down on the table, and I'm resolving. I said, okay, I have to drop it. I can't let my GPA be impacted because, you know, after all, that's what it's all about, right? Our GPA. And so I'm sitting there like, I have to drop Greek. I can't do this. This is one week in and I'm already drowning. But what happens next had to be nothing short of a miracle from God. Ron Ratliff with his sixth sense walks in and he looks at me and he says, what's wrong? And I tell him, I was like, Ron, I just can't do it. I can't do Greek. Like, it's just too hard. It's too difficult. And I will forever remember him and the words that he said to me at that moment. I will forever remember him telling me and encouraging me that I can do that. That I can do this. To just stick with it. To trust Mrs. Paddock's methods. To trust those around me. I will forever remember him sitting there, offering me sources that he used, offering him tips and tricks that he used to get through Greek. I will forever remember him telling me the impact that this will have on your ministry will be far greater than whatever you're struggling with right now. The kingdom of God is going to use you in such great ways, Cody. You just have to keep focusing. You can do this. And like only Ron can do, ends with a joke about himself saying that if I could do Greek, if I could learn Greek, then anybody can. And those words that he said to me at that time stuck with me. And after countless sleepless nights, after more note cards than I can count, or use a calculator to probably count, the persistent ranch hands involved in my Greek and involved in investing in me, I'm proud to say that I've not only completed the required Greek courses, but that I have gone on to a fifth and additional semester because this is something that is so valuable to me, to each and every one of us. As the Word of God has never come more alive, the Scriptures living and breathing in me, all because a ranch hand took the time and invested. You see, it'd be really easy for me to leave this college armed with all the knowledge of the Bible. But if it weren't for the examples set forth by Dr. Henry and Dr. York, I would leave this school in the words of Dr. Where's your schmuck? I would leave this school full of head knowledge and ready to go tackle anything, only to be burning a lot of bridges and saying a lot of things that I don't mean. But it's because of those men sitting down with me and showing me firsthand what it's like to live a life that reflects Christ. That those men sitting down with me, letting me just ask the simplest of questions that have seemingly obvious answers about the day in the life of a pastor, is because of them letting me sit down and just converse about that. That I'm able to leave here and have a better idea of what it looks like to live a life modeled after Christ. While there isn't time to name every ranch hand, they will continue working in each and every one of our lives. They're not only professors. Back in my childhood, where I kept catching the ball with my face, my dad stood by me as a ranch hand. He stood by even when he got frustrated, even when times were rough. He stood by so that he cultivated me, and eventually I would learn how to play catch. Right now, we are the trees. We're planted among believers, seemingly growing, but in reality, some of us have stopped growing, and some of us have stopped producing fruit altogether. We're sitting here waiting for that diploma, waiting to just finish and to just be enough. But luckily for us, Jesus is breaking the dirt around us, and he's recruiting the ranch hands throughout our life to continue to invest in us and to throw some poop on us in order that we may start producing fruit so that we may go out and impact the kingdom. You see, graduating from MCC does not make us perfect, but rather has provided a healthy and a strong system of roots so that we may one day be fruitful for the kingdom of God that is at hand, that we may one day leave here and go and inspire others with the living, breathing word of God, that we may bring hope and love and joy into other people's lives because the message of God is so present on our heart that we can't help but overflow from our abundance. Regardless of where we are called to after MCC, vocational ministry or everyday ministry, the world is going to look at us as if we have the answers simply because of the degree that is next to our name. Now, how much greater would it be for the impact of the kingdom if we actually had fruit to give to them? How much greater would it be for the kingdom if we were able to overflow love and grace onto other people? How much greater of an impact for the kingdom if we just remain faithful? As we leave here today, it is my prayer that we get pooped on. Quite frankly, with all of that awkwardness, it's my prayer that we leave here today with that sense of urgency of Romans 11, that fear of being cut off from the vine, not to scare into faith, or not to scare you into some way, but so that you can be further, that we can be further affirmed in the power and the love that the Holy Spirit has for us. It's my prayer today that we would leave and have the ground broken up around us and filled with poop to be ranch hands in other people's lives so that someday we may share our fruit and cultivate others. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your love and for your mercy. Lord, we know we don't deserve it. But you are so loving and so awesome that you provided your Son for us. Provided your Son to dig up the roots around us, to reinvest nutrients into the soil so that we can be fruitful, even though we don't deserve it. Lord, you are so great, you are so good. We pray for everyone in this room, Lord. I pray that as we leave today, that we could have our hearts and our minds changed. That we can leave here with a newfound passion for the scriptures, a passion for your word, Lord, so that we can be fruitful in every aspect of our lives and in everything that we do. Lord, it's in your holy name that all God's people pray.
Yes, you'll be there.